Hi, it's Bob Kraft of TennisMinistry.org, a series on the pro tennis players during the decade 2000 to 2012. And today I'd like to talk a little bit about Svetlana Kuznetsova. She's been on the tour. Her situation is she was training in Spain, in Barcelona. She left her homeland of Russia. She's always been someone who's been, say, in the, between number 5 and number 10 on the rankings. During the early part of her career, she's been a very physically talented player, and people felt that she wasn't emotionally able to win the top matches during that period of time. And she was training in Barcelona. She left her homeland. She was, over a period of time, she had coaches there. She was unhappy. She grew very unhappy, partially because it was a very controlling situation where the coaches would try to control her, and they would tell her, don't go back to Russia. And she loved Russia. She loved her homeland. She loved her family back there. And she missed it. And eventually she made the break between Spain. She moved back to Russia, and she took on a coach named Olga, who had been a former player back in the 70s, a very good player. And so she reestablished herself for Russia. And she's had a few other coaches during that time. Now, one thing about Svetlana was I knew she was an emotional person. She's an emotional kind of a person. She's happy when she loses a match. She's very sad. She doesn't really get angry. I've never really seen her get angry, but I've seen those swing of emotions from happiness to sadness. And, you know, one of the things with me you could call me a mental expert, but it's with Christ's help, you know, was to try to balance a person out and to make them stable so they're not swinging from highs to lows. And that also shortens your career. And so I started to talk to her, and she would see me around some of the top players like Mary Pierce or Justine Henin and others. And so she knew that I was around top players. And I think that always kind of attracted her a little bit to what I did. And she would wear a cross. And so I would, I went up to her and just spoke to her about it. And I said, are you a Christian? And she said, yes. She's a Russian Orthodox Christian. And the very first conversations I had, it was interesting because the first time I spoke with her, I told her I'd come back and talk to her again. And, she didn't speak a whole lot of English. It was broken English. And I was a little bit intimidated by her because she's kind of got a strong, bubbly personality. And plus I was working with so many other players. And it took me about 2 years to get back to her. And I felt very badly about that because that two-year period, I could have had contact. And I went, and when I reestablished contact with her, I went up to her. It took a lot of courage to go up to her again. And she knew, that I didn't really follow up on my word, and I just apologized to her. I said, I'm very sorry I didn't come and talk to you earlier, and I told her why, what my feelings were, and she was okay with that. And she asked me, she was a little bit afraid of me because Orthodox Christianity and evangelical Christians, in many cases, they're taught, in her case, she was taught that we're something like a cult, or we're something very wrong with us. The church is outside of the Orthodox Christianity, where they use incense and, the Russian Orthodox, they're wrong. And I told her, I said, no, I said, we believe in the same things. And I went over the death of Christ, the resurrection, and, I went over all these basic tenets of our faith, Mary, the virgin birth. And from that moment on, she was okay. Once she understood that we believed in the similar kind of things, she was fine. And from that moment on, she let me be around. We talked, and she'd smile. Now, because of her emotions, she'd go up, she'd go down. Sometimes if she's down, I couldn't really talk to her very easily. But she's always open to me. But, of course, I was looking for the opportunity when she's up. When she's bubbly, happy, she's had a good win, she's playing well, and then it's much easier to talk to her. So I would stop her and we'd have a bit of a chat. I've sat at her table with her. So I of course, in her situation, I was hoping I could give her some material. I might have given her some material in Russian. I can't remember. I do know she likes to listen to music. So I gave her Toby Mac, which is a hip-hop artist, Christian hip-hop artist. I took me about a year to get all those CDs together, all that music together, and I gave her the CD disc. And, you know, I believe she listened to it, and I'm hoping that will have an impact on her heart, because she likes rap, she likes hip-hop, and she loves music. And then I saw her at the U.S. Open. She was in the finals. Did she win that? I'm not really sure if she did or not. It seems like she won that U.S. Open a couple years ago. But I saw her at the Player Hotel, and I just was having to stay in the Player Hotel and minister to players that year. And I was sitting there, and she came down. It's the finals, and she came over, and I said, hey, Svetlana. I call her Sveti, and I said, I have something I want to say to you. And I said, is it all right if I say something to you? And she said, looked at me, and she's getting in the car to go to the finals. That's a critical moment. And she said, yeah. And I said, I reached around, I gave her a hug, and I said, and God really put that on my heart. I prayed a lot about it, because it's not something I like to do, number one, to people, men and women, and it's not something I really even feel that comfortable with. But God was really saying, you know, she really needs to have the love of Christ for her. She needs to understand the love of Christ and the real love of Christ, and because there's something missing in the love there. And I gave her a hug, and I said, Jesus loves you. And she stood up, and she looked at me, and she shook her head, and she smiled. She got in the car and drove away, you know. Then, as I remember, she won the tournament. And, well, gosh, that's a great thing, you know. Jesus loves you, and he wants to send somebody to tell you that. It's not some remote thing that you just don't ever think about, or that's not true. Really is true. Jesus loves you, and he can replace that hole in your heart where there's an absence of love, because sometimes players don't grow up with their family members around. They grew up in Barcelona, Spain, for example. And, you know, he can replace that, and he can put his love in your heart. And that's our prayer for everybody. That's called being born again, when Christ comes in and he becomes part of who you are. And, you know, I've seen her a few times since. I saw her in Beijing. And again, you know, I always say that God loves you. Jesus loves you. That's the word I use for Svetlana. And I will continue to do it. Now, you know, are we seeing each other? Are we doing Bible studies? I do pray for her a lot. I encourage her with the love of God. That's what I do. That it's not some distant thing. That's not real. But it's real for her. That's my role there. And, you know, everywhere the role is a little bit different. So that's Svetlana.